Azael shall Jehu slay, and him that escapeth the sword of Jehu shall Elisha slay. And yet have I had let me, how many? 7,000 in Israel, all the knees which have not bowed unto Baal, and every mouth which have not kissed him. Elijah was ignorant of those 7,000 men. He could have brought them together in a conference like this 7,000. He could have passed on the vision, the fire, the power, the revelation, and the desire to get the work done. He could have passed to all those 7,000 people. He did not. If he could get the whole of Israel together, and if he could say to them, how long are you going to stand between two opinions? If God be God, let's serve him. And then if Baal is God, let us serve him. If he could get them together, he could get 7,000 people together who hate Baal, who hate idolatry, and he could join hands with him. But he did not. He didn't even know Elisha. He didn't even know Jehu. And the Lord is saying, I know them. And the Lord had to be giving him the names, that the resources that he had, that he didn't know. And we have the resources, and we're going to do the work in Jesus' name. Let me just point your attention to this. One of the resources, that's Jehu. The other person the Lord gave him, you have Elisha. Let's think about Jehu for a moment. Let's look at 2 Kings chapter 10. 2 Kings chapter 10, and I'm reading there from verse 20. 2 Kings chapter 10, verse 20. But Jehu said, proclaim a solemn assembly for Baal, and proclaim it. And then Jehu sent through all Israel, and all the worshippers of Baal came, so that there was not a man left that came not. And they came into the house of Baal, and the house of Baal was full from one end to another. Look at verse 25. And it came to pass as soon as he had made an end of offering burnt offering, that Jehu said unto the guard and to the captains, go in and slay them. Let none come forth. And they smote them with the edge of the sword, and the guards and the captains cast them out, and went to the city, or to the house of Baal. And then it says, and they brought forth the images out of the house of Baal, and burnt them. And they break down the image of Baal, and break down the house of Baal, and made it a drought house unto this day. And thus Jehu did what? Tell me out loud. Jehu destroyed Baal out of Israel. And Elijah did not know Jehu when he was complaining. I'm the only one left. And I've tried a little. And all those prophets of Baal I killed. And there are still thousands of the worshippers of Baal there. Who is going to do this? And I'm tired already. Let me go home. Let me die. I'm not better than any of my fathers. And the Lord said, there are resources there that will do, and that can do what you never imagine will be done. And then Elisha, you know the story of Elisha, that prophet that received the double portion of the Spirit of God. The Lord is telling us, to get this work done, the resources are there, we're going to use, you will use them in Jesus' name. I need to point something to your attention in 1 Samuel chapter 22. 1 Samuel chapter 22. I was looking at David in this case now. Resources that we sometimes belittle them. We sometimes think they cannot do it. What can they do? Let's look at the resources that David had. We're looking at chapter 22 of 1 Samuel. 1 Samuel chapter 22. I'm reading from verse 1. And David therefore departed thence, and escaped to the cave of Adullam. And when his brethren and all his father's house heard it, they went down hither to him. Look at verse 2. And everyone that was in distress, and everyone that was in debt, and everyone that was discontented, gathered themselves unto him, and he became a captain over them, and there were with him about 400 men. You know, David, he was running about, and Saul had thousands in his army, and here was David all alone, and he was to fight against all this and be able to preserve his life and become the king in Israel eventually. And the people that came to him, they were not people that you will see can be useful at all. The people that were in distress, and the people that are owing debt, and the people were discontented, and then all these people gathered and said, he could have said, you're not the kind of people I need at this time. I need some strong people. I need some Elites. I need some people that can get this done and get this done. I don't need you at this time. Thank you for coming. But I need some support at this time. Supporters that have weight. Supporters that have some power and some skill and some training. But David accepted them the way they were, in debt, in distress, and all that. Let's look at the next chapter, chapter 23, verse 13. Chapter 23, verse 13. Then David and all his men, all those discontented people, the which were about 600, arose and departed out of Keilah, and went whithersoever they could go. They now became 600. Chapter 27, verse 2. In chapter 27, we're looking at verse 2 now. It says in verse 2, David arose and he passed over with the 600 men that were with him unto Achish. These were people that were just running away from Saul and from the army of Saul. But in the meantime, David was training them. He was training them. He was training them. Even though they were distressed, even though they were in debt, even though they were discontented, and yet all along he kept on training them. We're now coming to 2 Samuel chapter 21. 2 Samuel chapter 21. And you're going to see what happened over here. He had trained them to the point now they now did something. 2 Samuel chapter 21. And I'm reading there from verse 15. 2 Samuel chapter 21. We're looking at verse 15. Moreover, the Philistines had yet war against Israel, and David went down, and his servants, that is all these 600 with him, and fought against the Philistines. And David waxed faint, and Ishbi-benoth, which was of the sons of the giants, a relative of Goliath that he had killed, the weight of whose spear weighed 300 shekels of brass in weight, he, being guarded with a new sword, thought to have slain, to have killed David. And Abishai, the son of Zeruiah, succored him, and he smote the Philistine and killed him. Then the men of David swear unto him, saying, thou shalt go no more out with us to battle, that thou quench not the light of Israel. You know, David, he still wanted to be fighting along with them. And I was getting older and fainting. But all these 600 that he has trained, one of them then came and killed that Philistine. And then everybody said, David, you've done enough. We will finish the rest. You will finish it. I said you will finish it. And now look at this. And it came to pass that after this, that there was again a battle with the Philistine of Atgon, that Shebashiah and the Hushathite slew Sib. And then it says, which was of the sons of the giants. And there was again a battle in Gob with the Philistines, where Elanan, the son of Jeareoregim, and a Bethlehemite slew the brother of who? Goliath, the Gittite, not David. It wasn't David that slew this one. The people that he had trained. You know, you understand that David had 5 stones that he wanted to use, and he only used one. Why? Why 5 stones? There were 5 people like Goliath and his 4 brothers. And those 4 brothers were still alive. And David had not had a chance to use the 4 stones that was left. He only cast one, and Goliath came down. And the story we're reading now says that David did not kill the rest of the 4, the people that followed him. that he trained, the resources that were there, that he didn't know that were there, they were the people that took on all those people. His sister staff, of whose spear was like a weaver's beam. Verse 20, and there was yet a battle in Gath, where was a man of great stature, that had on every hand 6 fingers, and on every foot 6 toes, 4 and 20 in number. And he also was born to the giant. And it says, and when he defied Israel, Jonathan, the son of Shimeah, the brother of David, slew him. Look at verse 22. These four, the four brothers of Goliath, these four were born to the giant in Gath, and fell by the hand of David and by the hand of his servants. That's what you are saying. David never knew that he had people that he had trained, he was training. He didn't know that all these people in distress, all these people in debt, all these people are discontented, that he could do such mighty acts that eventually they did. And what you are saying is, all the members of the churches that we have, they've been there for 3 years or 4 years or 5 years or 7 years, and they're just sitting down there, and you are still saying they are not qualified, they are not qualified, they have this, they have this. Get them up and brush them up and polish them up and train them. They will do the work with us. I said they will do the work with us. Because now, as we're planting new churches and planting new locations, all the people that we think were not qualified before, the grace of God will qualify them in Jesus' name. Chapter 23 from verse 1. 2 Samuel chapter 23 from verse 1. Now these be the last words of David. David the son of Jesse. And the man who was raised up on high, the anointed of the God of Jacob, and the sweet psalmist of Israel, said, the Spirit of the Lord spake by me, and his word was in my tongue. You see, David, this David, as much as he had, all these good things that he had, he passed it on. That's why he gave us the Psalms. You know, if he did at Joseph's time, if he's only fighting the Amalekites and fighting the Philistines and fighting this and fighting this, all that he preserved for us in the Psalms, he would not have been able to do. And when our pastors, when our overseers, when they are the only people sweating and getting the work done, there are some other areas of work that we need to do. And it is by adjusting our mind, adjusting our time, adjusting our worldview, and the responsibilities we have. I need to drop that so I can do this other thing. I need to give that to other people so I can do this other thing. I need to be able to, you know, drop this and give it to some sisters or brothers so that I can concentrate on this other thing. That is the readjustment that we need, so that the work we need to do at this time, we'll do it together in Jesus' name. 2 Samuel chapter 23 verse 8. These be the names of the mighty men whom David had. He had mighty men eventually. Those distressed men and those discontented men and those people that were in debt, after training them for some time, they now became mighty men. It says in verse 8, it talks about the Tachmonite. And then it says that such in the siege of the chief among the captains, the same was Adino. And then it says the Esnite. Then it tells us he lit up his spear against 800 whom he slew at one time. He trained one of those people that were able to slay 800 at one time. You know, some of the people that were raising up, they'll be able to have a church as large as 800. I thought you'd say good amen. In verse 9, after this, after him was Eliezer, the son of Dodo, the Ahohite, one of the three mighty men. What, David, one of the three mighty men. All the people were already about before, discontented and distressed, and you know, they were riffraffs in the world, and they came to him. At the time they came to him, there were nobody, but he trained them up. This year is going to be a year of training. That you train all the people. We're no more saying you have a few workers. All those members, we're going to transform them to become leaders and workers and soul winners and witnesses and preachers in Jesus' name. That's what he did for them. They were told, it says of the three mighty men of David, when they defied the Philistines that were there, gathered together to the battle, and the men of Israel were gone away. He arose and he smote the Philistines until his hand was weary and his hand clave unto the sword. And the Lord wrought a great victory that day, and the people returned after him only to spoil. And after him was Shaman, the son of Ajim. And then it says the Hararite, and the Philistines were gathered together into a troop. There was a piece of ground full of lentils, and the people fled from the Philistines. But then it says in verse 12, but he alone, he stood in the midst of the ground, and he defended it, and he slew the Philistines, and the Lord wrought a great victory. Look at the people that David restored out of those people that were left nobodies. Then he tells us in verse 13, and three of the 30 chief went down and came to David in the harvest time, and they were told unto the cave of Adullam, and the troop of the Philistines pitch in the valley of Rephaim. It says, and David was then in an hold, and the garrison of the Philistines was then in Bethlehem. And then David wanted to drink water, the water from Bethlehem, and these people went to the garrison of the Philistines, and they brought the water unto him. They did things, they did things, and we have people like that will go forth with courage, that will go forth with might, and they will do great mighty things in Jesus' name. Look at verse 18, and Abishai, the brother of Joab, the son of Zeruiah, was chief among the three, and he lifted up his spear against how many? 300, and slew them, and had the name among the three. Well, it goes on and on and on. And the Lord is telling us, all the people that are there, we may need to readjust and readjust the assignment, so that now they will be pastors, they will be preachers, and they will do the work of the Lord. We don't have time. If you come to the New Testament, you're going to find out 120 in the upper room in chapter 1, 3,000 in the church in chapter 2, and then you have another 5,000 in chapter 4, and multitudes in chapter 5, and a great number of priests that were bidding.